a building, a wonderful legacy of first and second generation scholars who have paved the way. We still have a lot of work to do in building and expanding the possibilities for underrepresented groups to be a part of this teaching world.
It's infectious. I mean, that sort of love and commitment is infectious. Other people, you take that with you and you say, oh, my job is to look around the room and see who's the next person that can follow me and bring them into the fold and into the community.
And Sharon has this way of saying a whole lot with just a few words, right? So there was this time, I'll never forget this. I was coming out, I think I was on my second cup of coffee that day. I really, really needed it. I think my son was probably keeping me up in his first 6 months, not sleeping through the night. And I think I was pretty weary this time. And Sharon saw me, and I think she probably caught my weariness. And she looked over, she said, "Matt, do it for the people," and kept walking down the hallway. And in that moment, in just those few words, Sharon's, not just her words, but the energy behind those words and the personal example that she embodied behind those words really refocused me in that moment and said to me, "Matt, you know what? This work and the reason Sharon does this work is not about her own kind of personal advancement, ambition, but she really has a sense and has always had a sense that she's connected to a tradition and a cause and a struggle that goes far beyond her. So she's doing it for the people, and she always has."
I first met Sharon in 1998 when we had both been independently hired by Jim Waits to come and work with him to recreate the Fund for Theological Education.
All of us know the kind of contribution that she's made and the spirit and the kind of the enthusiasm that she brings to her work. And I think it was that that made me want to interview her over and over again. And I've learned an awful lot from her through those conversations. She did decide to come with us, and she and Melissa Wigginton, of course, were the first two of the professional program directors.
So we were just starting really from square one, but she had this, and I don't know if she felt like it was a burden or an opportunity, but this reputation of greatness sort of sitting on her shoulders. Her four stages of identification, support, retention, and placement. And she developed this framework, you know, and I thought she got it out of a book or something because it was so professional, it was so well thought out. And finally, after about 5 years, I said, "Sharon, where did you get that?" And she said, "Well, that's just what you do," you know, in her very Sharon way of saying, "Well, Melissa, those are the four steps," you know, and I believed her, and it was totally, it worked.
A legacy of Sharon Fluker's, which we haven't completely seen, but which we will see in the next 5, 10, 15, 20, 25 years, is the kinds of connections and challenges and changes and contributions that these persons will make, not only as Black religious scholars, but to the religious academy in terms of helping to shape what kind of community it is, and in terms of helping to shape the kind of scholarship that is coming out of the Religious Academy.
When I think about my work ahead, I think that Sharon's already kind of blazed that trail, and FDE has been at the forefront of doing what we probably should have been doing 10 years ago. I think she has a file, it's like the CIA, she has a file on everyone. And she pulls this file out, and she's on the phone, and you know when she gets off, she'll be giddy with excitement, she'll say, X or Y has finished their dissertation or defended their dissertation or got a job or signed a book contract. That's the kind of trajectory, the kind of the grand scale of mentoring that she's involved in.
Mm-hmm. 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 Mm-hmm.
probably into my second year of writing the dissertation, I bumped into Sharon at an AAR conference. And Sharon reminded me politely but energetically, kind of in a motherly way, that I needed to finish so I could get out in the job market and, you know, be vocationally what I've been called to be. And so for me, at least, what was memorable about that is that I realized that Sharon was just not the person telling us information about funding, but that Sharon was a person that deeply cared about the rest of our vocational lives. The important work of FTE is trying to recruit a person such as myself as an African-American female, now African-American female scholar, to say that your intellectual production matters, and that your intellectual production then changes, or at least puts a focus or sheds light on new ways of saying things about God, about the church, about our society, about religion, about the way that interacts with the public sphere.
And then she said, "Greg, this is not about you." And I sat back in my seat and she told me, she said, "When you finish, you give people hope. I'm trying to plant a seed for others such that your successful completion of this program gives hope to your colleagues who are also struggling. And you've had a difficult year." That said a lot to me about her care and concern for not only me as a person, but for this community. And Dr. Fluker has not only been a mentor, but a friend. And so much so that I've decided with my wife that I'm writing FTE into my will, because more so than any institution, including the church, FTE has nurtured.
What Sharon did with these programs was that beyond just providing money, which is very important in a doctoral program because it's such an expensive endeavor, Sharon recognized that it's expensive in other ways as well. It can be very isolating. And in that way, the people who get into this work for the sake of community often don't experience community in the process. So what she did was she began to build a community. And that community has comprised senior faculty and fellows who have been incredible supports to one another in a process that, again, can be very isolating. But she's helped to build a community that has held kind of a source and a space for accountability, a source and a space for support, a source and a space for strategy, so that folks really not only get into programs and doctoral programs and move through graduate programs, but they thrive and flourish in the profession. And community is a really important part of that. And I think that's been the signature contribution of the Fluker era. It's been community building, both among peers and among senior faculty. That hasn't happened before now.
Dr. Fluker, thank you. Thank you for all that you've meant for me and my family.
You are such a part of my life and such a part of me that I am grateful to carry you with me.
I'm thankful for all of your work, all of your love, and I wish you the best in your future and your endeavors. I carry you with me always.
You have a legacy that has contributed to an enormous change and a productive change in theological work.
Wherever you go, you will simply be a blessing. You will enrich the lives of those that whom you serve and for those that you find yourself in community with. So blessings, blessings, and know we're gonna miss you, but we hope that you'll come back to us, and we wanna continue, I do at least, wanna continue to engage you in the future.
You have amazing things ahead of you because the work that you've already done has already set high marks for everyone that's worked for you. I wish you the very best.
We will miss your continuous presence here, but we know that you make great contributions where you're going, and we thank you for the ways that you have been a professional in Atlanta, and a personal friend. All the best to you, and we look forward to seeing you in the community.